my homily style will be a little bit different than usual. Usually I focus on the readings, and this is what the homily is supposed to be. Take the readings of the day, the gospel of the day, and try to put it into perspective our daily lives, to explain the Word of God, how we can live it in our daily lives. Today I will do something different. This will be more of a teachable moment. Today we celebrate Corpus Christi, the body and blood of Christ. We celebrate the fact that Jesus stayed with us in the Eucharist for all eternity. So I will focus a little bit on the signs, symbols, and the history that we celebrate in the Mass, during the Mass. What do we do during the Mass? We come here every week, and we got so accustomed to doing this, so we just go through routine gestures and prayers, and yet we do not know the background. You see, when Jesus lived, there were two places of worship in Israel. There were the synagogues, and there was the temple. The worship service in the synagogue consisted mainly of prayers and instructions. The worship service in the temple consisted mainly of prayers and sacrifice. And the Mass combines both of those worship services. The first part of the Mass, that we call the Liturgy of the Word, corresponds to the worship service in the synagogue and consists mainly of prayers and instructions. And the second part of the Mass, the Liturgy of the Eucharist, corresponds to the worship service at the temple and consists of prayers and instructions. We come from deep Judeo-Christian tradition. We build our roots in Jewish tradition. And everything that we do here during the Mass comes either from the Judeo-Christian tradition or most of it is from the scriptures. So at the very beginning, when we start the Mass, we started with a procession. The focal point of that procession is the gospel, the large gospel. This is because this is the Word of God, and we are going to celebrate the liturgy of the Word. We will focus on the Word of God. When we reach the altar, the priest and the deacon kisses the altar. We venerate the altar. This goes back, the tradition goes back to the beginning of Christianity. When Christians were gathering for their worship, and they were persecuted in Rome, they could not worship openly. So they had to gather in their secret places, and their favorite place to gather was the catacombs, the underground burial grounds. So they would gather around the tomb of a martyr, somebody who died for faith. And if somebody dies because of their faith, they are already saints. So in this case, when they gathered, the leader, the priest, would first kiss the tombstone of the martyr before they would start their celebration. Then later on, when Christians could celebrate openly, they were not persecuted anymore, the tradition was kept, and a relic of a martyr, of a saint, would be placed in the altar. So whenever a priest came to celebrate the Mass, he would kiss a relic that was placed the altar. Now, after Second Vatican Council, we do not place relics in the altar anymore, but we still keep the tradition. Out of reverence for what is going to happen at this altar in a few minutes, the priest and the deacon venerates the altar. We kiss the altar. Then we start the Mass in the name of Trinity, in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and we celebrate Trinity last Sunday. And then we have the greeting, the Lord be with you and with your spirit. And then we have the penitential plan. And this is exactly what Jesus told us to do. He said, if you come to do your offering, and you remember that you have sent something against your brother, or your brother has something against you, leave your offering at the altar, go and reconcile with your brother first, and then come back your offering. We ask forgiveness. We ask forgiveness from from God for our failings, and also we ask each other to forgive those failings that we have against each other. This is the penitential prayer. Then we have glory. Glory to God in the highest. This is an ancient hymn that is based on the scriptures. You remember when Jesus was born in Bethlehem, angels appeared to the shepherds, and they sang that song, glory to God in the highest. They announced to them that Christ was born. When the shepherds heard this announcement, they heard through the night and placed themselves in the presence of the newborn Christ. So this hymn also invites us to do the same. Invites us to place ourselves in the presence of Christ. In a few minutes, he will be truly present in the Eucharist. We sing glory to God in the highest, because shortly God will be here present in the Eucharist. Then we have the opening prayer, which we say at the end of the opening prayer, Amen. The priest says the prayer, but anytime we say Amen during the Mass, the word Amen, it's a Hebrew word which means so be. I agree with you. I make your prayer my prayer. Amen. Then we have the reading rite. There are two selections from the Old Testament and two selections from the New Testament. And once again, we follow the Jewish tradition. When Jesus read the scriptures in his time in the synagogue, they were following 3-year cycle, A, B, and C. And this is what we do also here during the Mass. We follow 3-year cycle, A, B, C, so every 3 years, all of the readings are being repeated. Sometimes we Catholics are accused that we do not know the Bible, but if we come every Sunday to the Mass, the most important readings from the Bible, we hear from here. We might not remember the verses and the pages, but we do know the stories. We know those stories by our heart, because we listen to them every Sunday. When Jesus went to the synagogue, it is in one of the letters, when he went to the synagogue to read, he was given the scroll of prophet Isaiah. He read the scroll. Then he put it aside and he said, today in your hearing, those words are being fulfilled. And all people were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. So we can see Jesus doing two things. Reading the scripture and explaining the scripture. And this is exactly what we do during the liturgy of the group. We read the scripture and then we explain the scripture. So the first two selections are from the Old Testament. And somebody might say, why do we use Old Testament readings? Now we are in the New Testament era. We should probably, you know, be focused only on the New Testament readings. But St. Augustine was very good when he explained it. He said, we are growing out from the Jewish tradition. Those are our foundations. Those are our roots. So the Old Testament reading, it's almost like a flower bowl. And the New Testament readings are the flower. So what is concealed in the Old Testament, it is finally revealed in the New Testament. We grow out from the Judeo-Christian tradition. We read both books, the Old Testament and the New Testament. Of course, the high point of the liturgy of the word is the reading of the Gospel. The Gospel can be read during the Mass only by ordained minister. That'll be a deacon or a priest. And we highlight the importance of that reading by standing up and introducing the Gospel with chant, which we call the Gospel acclamation. Then the deacon or priest says, the reading from the Gospel, which Gospel it is being read, and we trace cross on our foreheads, our lips, and our heart. Once again, it is an ancient tradition, and that the meaning of it is, may the Word of God be in our minds, and our lips, and in our hearts, that we may proclaim it by word and example. After that comes the homily. Some people might say that's the most boring part of the Mass. Other people say it is interesting part of the Mass. See, to deliver a good homily is not an easy thing to do, because we have so many people from many different walks of life, ages, different levels of education, so it is not an easy thing to do. But once again, St. Augustine said that whenever the scriptures are read in the church, it is Christ himself who speaks. And whenever the scriptures are explained in the church, it is Christ himself who speaks. So we need to keep it in mind, because like I said, it is not an easy thing to do. And especially when the priest speaks with kind of Irish brogue, it's not easy to get all of the ideas. But if we listen with open minds, the Holy Spirit will guide us. The Holy Spirit will give us some seeds to grow. After that, we have the Creed. The word means, I believe. This is what we believe in. If somebody asked us to summarize our Catholic faith in 1 minute, can we do it? Yes, we can. This is exactly what we do when we recite the Creed. This is the essential belief of our Catholic faith, the Creed. This is why we stand for the Creed, because this is what we Catholics stand for. Somebody might ask, why do we stand or sit or kneel during certain parts of Mass? The general rule is this: we stand to proclaim. We proclaim the Creed, we proclaim the Gospel. We sit to listen. We listen to the readings, we listen to the homily, and we kneel to show reverence. So when the Creed is over, we have the prayers of the faithful, the common prayers. And this is exactly what Jesus told us to do. He said, ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find. This is what we do during the prayers of the faithful. Somebody once said that the prayers of the faithful are written from two sources, the best prayers of the faithful. One source is the Bible, the other source is the newspaper. And this is what we do. We use our faith to ask God to help us to live our faith in daily lives, to express to him our concerns, our desires, our worries. We pray together for all of them. And the prayers of the faithful conclude the first part of the Mass, which is the liturgy of the word. The second part of the Mass is the liturgy of the Eucharist, which, like I said, corresponds to the worship service in the temple and consists of prayers and sacrifice. Just like the first part of the Mass starts with procession, and the focal point of that procession is the Gospel book, so the second part of the Mass also starts with procession, and the focal point of that is the gifts that are brought to the altar, the bread and wine, which will shortly become the body and blood of Christ. During the liturgy of the Eucharist, we do exactly what Jesus did at the Last Supper. The Gospel tells us that Jesus took the bread and wine, then he said a blessing, and then he gave it to his disciples. So this is what we do. We take the bread and wine, and we call it the preparation of gifts. Then we say our prayers, the blessings, and we call the Eucharistic prayer. And then we give this body and blood of Christ to others, and we call it the communion service. So, the preparation of gifts. When the priest and deacon receives the gifts, the priest recites their ancient Hebrew table prayer. And this is the prayer that Jesus actually prayed probably every day. The priest says, blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands, that will become for us the bread of life. He does the same with the cup, the wine. And then we go to the Eucharistic prayer, the most important part of the liturgy of the Eucharist. We need to remember that the Eucharist is a memorial meal. Do this in memory of me. Jesus said this directly to us. Do this in memory of me. You see, in this place here, in this moment, our Protestant brothers and sisters, they're saying, well, you see, this is not a true presence. It is a memorial. Jesus said, do this in memory of me. Well, we need to know exactly what Jesus meant when he said this. He said this when he celebrated the Passover. Celebrating Passover for the Jewish people was much more than just remembering. They believed that through the eyes of faith, when they were celebrating Passover, they were recalling the past events, bringing them in the present, and reliving them just as truly as the people who participated in the original events. When they celebrated Passover, they believed that they participated in the original Passover that all of the Jewish people through all of the history were participating. And this is also what we believe about the Eucharist. When we come to celebrate the Eucharist, it is not a new Eucharist every time. It is the same Eucharist that Jesus instituted. We believe that the events from the past, we recall them, we place ourselves in them, and we celebrate those events just as truly as the disciples with him when they were celebrating the Passover. So, there are a few different levels of memorials. There's ordinary memorial, living memorial, and then there is the Mass for the Passover. Ordinary memorial is, well, if somebody lived and that person was famous, people wanted to remember him when he died, they erect his statue, so each time they walk by, they see the person and they remember that person. Living memorial is higher level of memorial, which means that if somebody was dedicated, let's say, to education, and then he died, so we built a library in his memory. Now we not only remember him, but we also continue his legacy. We continue the work that he was dedicated to when he lived in this world. So this is the living memorial. And then the highest level of memorial is the Mass or the Passover, where we believe that we participate in the original events that happened maybe 2,000 years ago. But we recall them and relive them. It is not a new Eucharist, it is the same Eucharist that Jesus celebrated. So, when Jesus said, "Do this in memory of me," he had that kind of memorial in his mind. We need to know that we Catholics, we believe that there's true presence of Christ in the Eucharist. When we receive his body and blood, he is truly present. Sometimes people may question how, but Jesus actually said at the Last Supper, "This is my body, this is my blood." He did not say, "This is a symbol of my body, this is a memorial of my body." He said, "This is my body." In today's Gospel, actually, he was talking to the Jewish people there, and he said, "Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood shall have everlasting life." And people said, "This talk is tough. We are not going to listen to this anymore. We cannot take it." At this moment, Jesus did not say, "Wait a minute, let me explain to you how is this going to work." Basically, he said to them, "Well, if you cannot believe it, then you go." He meant what he said. He said what he meant. We believe that he is truly present in the Eucharist. And after that, we have communion service. Once again, we believe in the true presence of Christ. That was St. Augustine who explained to us very well what happens when we receive the body of Christ. He said, you know, when we eat regular bread, when we eat normal food, that food becomes part of us. It changes into us. It nourishes our body physically and sustains us physically. That food changes into us. When we receive the bread of life, the body of Christ, the opposite happens. We change into what we receive. We become the body of Christ. We need to remember, because this is extremely important. The physical Jesus who lived 2,000 years ago is not in this world anymore, but he is present with us and in us and through us. When we receive the body of Christ, we become the body of Christ. And we become Christ-like in our world. We become his eyes, his feet, his hands, his mouth, to proclaim the good news and help others. He's calling us to do what he did when he lived in this world. And then at the end, we have the dismissal. You receive a blessing and commission. Go into the world to proclaim the good news. And sometimes people might say, okay, my obligation is over. I came to Sunday Mass. And next, I'm done for a week. And next week, I'll come back. But this is just the beginning of our Christian life. You see, Jesus calls us together. He does to us what he did with his disciples. He calls us and we come. He teaches us. In the liturgy world, we listen to his words. Then he strengthens us in the liturgy of the Eucharist. And then he sends us out from the church to be the church in our world. We are the body of Christ in today's world.